Today we're meeting Dag Svanaes in Aarhus in Denmark. Dag is a professor at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology in Trondheim. Since the late 1980s, Dag has been teaching and doing research in HCI. One of his main areas of interest is the philosophy of interaction, and this topic is what he'll introduce us to in this interview. So, Dag, welcome. Let's start with the very fundamental philosophical question. What is the very nature of interactivity?
The nature of interactivity. We have two ways of seeing interactivity. You can see interactivity from the point of the interactive thing, the interactive object, the interactive artifact, or you can see interactivity from the perspective of the user. And from the perspective of the artifact, it's possible to describe the interactivity as the way in which the artifact responds to actions by the user. Mm-hmm. So you can describe the behavior of the artifact. So that is its interactivity.
Yeah.
From the user, then it becomes a little bit more complicated, because from a user perspective, things are interactive only as long as you interact with them. You need to interact. An object has the potential for interaction. So in the interactivity is there in the object, but to actually experience the interactivity, you have to engage in some kind of interaction. And it's only through this interaction that the interactivity of the object appears to you, that you sort of perceive that you have the interactive user experience, so to say.
Mm-hmm.
So what is interactivity? Interactivity is a potential for interactivity. So objects don't have interactivity as such, they have potential for interactivity.
Mm-hmm.
So you can play a computer game in different ways, you can press switches in different ways, you can operate a car in different ways. So the actual user experience is created by you in the interaction with the gadget.
Yeah. So that's very brief for a beginning.
Okay.
And then secondly, I'd like to know, can you give us like an overview of the different approaches to interactivity?
Right. First is this simply seeing it from the engineering perspective. And that's the more traditional computer science perspective of interactive, not even human-computer interaction, just the computer science perspective of interactivity. And this is about how do we build, when it comes to user interfaces, for example, how do we build user interfaces? How do we define what should happen when the user clicks on a button, when you draw, when you move a slider, etc., etc.? And this is the specification of the behavior of the system. And that is similar to more simple things in electronics, or even to sort of to make a hammer, how do you build it? So that's the engineering part of interactivity. And then you have the human computer science, the HCI perspective. And traditionally, or the first people who started to look at interactivity, they didn't call it interactivity, but they talked about human computer interaction, both from a cognitive science perspective. Or even going even further back, you have more of an ergonomics perspective.
Do you remember when this was, when this came up?
The ergonomic perspective is way back in the 50s or even earlier, where you see it more from an ergonomic, from a sort of physical, as a more a machine perspective. This is the root of the term man-machine interaction.
Mm.
So you see it more as a machine thing, sort of operating a machine,
more
sort of Charlie Chaplin Modern Times kind of interaction.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the cognitive science approach. And this was to a large extent inspired by the work on artificial intelligence that started back in the 1950s and 1960s. As you see, the HAL computer in Kubrick's 2001, Sorry Dave, I cannot do that. I mean, the idea that you'd have computers and that you can build computers with human-like behavior, that you can model the brain and build something similar to a human being.
Mm-hmm.
And from that perspective, they modeled the user side as if it was a computer. So you use a computer instead of sort of using a human as a model for the computer, which is the idea in artificial intelligence. Then you use this computer way of thinking about computation as a way of describing human behavior. So you have this sort of, you see yourself in the mirror and you sort of model the human from a as if it was a computer. And this gives rise to the whole idea of mental representations,
mm-hmm.
that we have mental representations of the user interface. So you describe the human-computer interaction as if it were two computers interacting, so to say. So you model the information flow. You have all these terms and all these concepts that you borrow from the computer side, and you apply them to the human user.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the basis for the human-computer interaction, the cognitive approach.
Yeah.
But if you want to do science, then it's not precise.
Okay, so in your opinion, is there a better way to understand the nature of interactivity?
One of the early criticism of this approach was Winogrand and Flores in their 1986 book about where they, among others, they brought in Heidegger and European continental philosophy as an alternative to this cognitive approach to HCI.
Mm-hmm.
I've been struggling with some of these things, feeling that these cognitive science theories didn't really sort of get to the core of what human-computer interaction was all about.
Mm-hmm.
And there was something missing here, I felt. And reading Winogrand and Flores was really sort of an eye-opener for me.
Yeah.
But this idea that we are, as users, we are not sort of primarily thinking and planning. We are in the environment,
mm-hmm.
and we act. That's the primary thing.
Yeah.
And that's the whole Heidegger idea, then, that we are, which is the break that Heidegger did back in the late 1920s with the philosophical tradition going back to Plato. So the break that we are not sort of primarily cognitive, thinking, reflecting people, individuals.
Mm-hmm.
Beings, we are in the world.
Yeah,
that's the primary thing, and then we should start with the way we are in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And then he starts his analysis of how we are in the world as a starting point for understanding what it means to be human.
Yeah.
So when it comes to actually doing interaction design or managing interaction design, that's where I find Heidegger and Merleau-Ponty really useful.
Mm-hmm.
To always keep some of these basic principles and always to have a focus, though. So it keeps you focused on what you're really doing here. Why are we doing these things?
Why does it keep you focused?
Because you always keep in mind that you are designing for users, that you are designing for use situations, and that you're designing for people.
Mm-hmm.
So to sort of keep you sort of focused, in the sense that even if you spend weeks getting the sort of the button right or getting the HTML code to work, etc., you still sort of at some you keep in mind that why you're doing this.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing this because you want to create a user experience. You're doing this because you want to build a system that people shall make use of for a certain purpose. You want to build something that should be interpreted in a certain way, or something that stands out, something that has some qualities. So it keeps your focus on the human side,
mm-hmm.
of human-computer interaction. And sort of, because it's easy to get so deep into the design, in the sense that you build the things, that you keep, that you forget the user and the use situation.
We'll go more into depth with that later.
Yeah.
But can you give us an overview of some more perspectives here in the beginning?
And you've had in the HCI field, you've had 6, 7, 8 different competing perspectives. You have activity theory with roots going back to Russia, to Vygotsky and the whole Russian psychology, work psychology mm-hmm. thing. You've had semiotics going back to the tradition in semiotics, like you have in Umberto Eco and this, you know semiotics. You've had more ethnomethodology and perspectives looking at the user in context, more inspired by fields, things you use in field studies, etc. So more to describe what's actually going in out there in the world with that methodology and different versions and variations of that.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the sort of the most used perspectives these days.
Thank you so much, Dag, for introducing the philosophy of interaction for us. And if you want to know more about it, you could read Dag's chapter at interactiondesign.org, and here you can also find videos like this one. And Dag will in the next videos be explaining about his main guidelines, and he'll also be explaining about his opinion on future directions. And at our site, you can also find more videos videos with other thought leaders, and you can find chapters written by thought leaders and inventors. Thank you so much for your time.